Hello everyone, and thanks for making time to join us today. Before we start, I'd like to go over some practical issues. So we will be recording the session and you will all receive an email with a link to the recording. If you miss that email, you can still view it on the CIMA Pro Help Center a few days later. So to do that, you can go to support.cimapro.com where you will find not only a recording of this session, but previous public webinars and other information about all our tools. So all attendees are muted. If you have any questions, please use the chat box and we will try to address them during the session, wherever relevant or at the Q&A at the end. So thanks again for joining. I'm Rutba, I'm the Senior Customer Services at Prey. And for a lot of you who have joined us on multiple sessions, nice to see you again. Our speaker for this session is Dr. Niels Jungblut, and he is CEO of ASU Services. ASU is our CIMAPRO partner covering Switzerland, Austria, and Germany, and they've been working extensively in the field of food for a while now. They even have developed a global food database, which we will hear more about later this session. On a personal note, Niels has quite an extensive background in consulting and teaching life cycle assessment for food, energy, biomass, but also has experience in consumption patterns and consumer behavior, to name a few. His scientific experience also includes being on the editorial board and carrying out peer reviews for many journals, which you are familiar with, including the International Journal of LCA, Cleaner Production, International Dairy Journal, Journal of Industrial Ecology, and several others. We're really happy to have Niels on board for this session. Thank you, Niels. Before I switch over to our speaker, I'd like to briefly introduce Prey as well. I'm sure many of you already know us, but it doesn't hurt to remind you that our main mission is to guide positive change with fact-based solutions. And our core values include innovation, transparency, and collaboration, which we take quite seriously. And that's why we try to deliver fact-based solutions not only through CIMAPRO, but we also play an active role in a variety of projects and initiatives like the PEF, the Social Roundtable, and we've been involved in the development of various impact assessment methods like RECIPE. So we're happy to service our large CIMAPRO family, which reaches more than 3,000 users, not only via Prey, but also our global partner network. As I mentioned previously, ASU Services is our partner in Switzerland, Austria, and Germany. So you'll see where the others are available on the map. And yeah, for me, that's it for now. I'll pass things over to Niels, and he'll be going over the agenda for the session and share his wisdom on the environmental impacts of food production and consumption. So Niels, I'll make you presenter for now.
Yes, thank you very much, Ruben. I hope that you can now see my screen and that you can follow my presentation. Thank you for this invitation to give this presentation here, this occasion as a webinar to all people interested in it. And yes, I can just start with it. First, I will present a little bit about our company, then I will give the main talk on the impacts and reduction potentials for food consumption and production. I will show a little bit about the ASU database, which is used for many of these studies. And then there will be time for questions. And if there's still time left, then we might look at a few further case studies related to ACA and food products. ASU Services has been funded about 20 years ago. We are a small consultancy with a clear focus on life cycle assessment. We serve customers from industry, universities, from administration, and from NGOs. And we have a large own database with more than 6,000 data sets, which we can use for our consultancy projects, but which we also sell to our customers. Well, as said, we are LCA consultancy, sustainability is a major challenge as we see it. And we think that reducing environmental impacts over the full life cycle of products and services is one of the key issues in reaching this sustainability. And we apply this transparent life cycle thinking to help our customers for reducing their environmental footprint. We offer all types of services from full-scaled LCA studies. We have simplified tools like key parameter models. We do LCA project management. We help with environmental product declarations and eco-labeling. We do literature surveys in the field of life cycle assessment. And we do also critical peer reviews or verifications of LCA studies and EPDs. We offer training and coaching in this field. And last but not least, we are also the original CIMAPRO Center for this LCA software, and as Ruba mentioned it. I think most of you are familiar with the LCA methodology, so I do not go into much details. I just want to raise two points regarding the lifecycle impact assessment methodology. We mainly use, this is the ecological scarcity method, which has been developed within Switzerland, and we apply it for most or many of our studies for Swiss customers. And my presentation today will also mainly focus on an impact assessment with this methodology. This covers a range of different environmental impacts like energy use, resource use, water use, all types of relevant emissions like climate change or ozone depletion, also wastes and ionizing radiation are part of this impact assessment method. And so it's one of the impact assessment methods which can be used to derive a single score. And I think in this field of food consumption and informing consumers, it's very necessary to have one single score at the end for educating people and showing results. And the ecological scarcity method with the version 2013 is based on the Swiss environmental targets in the legal process. So the weighting is finally done based on the importance of different themes in the Swiss legislation. So in contrast, for example, to the recipe method, where this weighting is more based on a scientific consensus. That's important to understand the results today. The results are mainly presented as eco points, and sometimes I also show results for the carbon footprint. Well, now I come to the main presentation about environmental impacts of consumption patterns in Switzerland and possible reduction potentials. This research is based on different projects, different funders, like mentioned here on the slide. And here I present our personal summary from these different research projects in the last 15 or 20 years. Key questions are, what are the total environmental impacts of consumption? How can they be allocated against consumption areas? What are the most important aspects within consumption areas, and which options exist for the reduction of environmental impacts due to decisions by the consumer? Well, if we look on private consumption, we have different fields like nutrition, mobility, health services, or buildings, including the heating and electricity use in heating. If we look on the total environmental impacts of Switzerland, of course, there are also public demands like for military or education. And one of the So for this, we did one of the first studies in Switzerland to evaluate these total environmental impacts of consumption. And this starts somehow from the point of view that all environmental impacts are somehow driven by this final demand by private people or by the public demand for the society. Well, in this, after investigating these total impacts for Switzerland, we looked at the share of different consumption areas. We made a further analysis of the consumption areas. Then we evaluated reduction potentials in the most important consumption areas. And finally, we derived then the reduction potentials in these different types of measures taken by the private consumers. And this I will explain now a little bit more in detail. While evaluating the total impacts in Switzerland has been done with an input-output analysis. In Switzerland is a small country, and so imports and exports are very relevant. Here we combine the input-output table with the LCA data, and we came to the following results per capita in Switzerland: about 10 million eco points of environmental impacts are caused directly by the Swiss households or by Swiss companies. We have to add the imports of goods and services to this balance, which make up for about 20 million eco points per person. And then we have to subtract the exports from the Swiss economy. And this finally leads to a total environmental impact of about 20 million eco points per person and a year in Switzerland. And as you see, a lot of these environmental impacts, more than 50%, are caused outside the Swiss boundaries. Then we calculated also with the help of the input-output table, and in the meantime, we have updated it a little bit. So now there are about 22 million eco points per year caused. These can be allocated with this input-output table to the consumption areas. According to this evaluation, food consumption or food purchases with 28% are the most important consumption area. Energy use in households accounts for about 19%, and private mobility accounts for about 13% of the total environmental impacts caused in Switzerland. So our further research focused on these three most important consumption areas and the reduction potentials in these areas. We have evaluated the environmental impacts also with other environmental impact assessment methods. One of the important findings is that if you just look on energy or greenhouse gases, the environmental impacts of nutrition or food are normally lower or show a lower share. And this is due to the fact that many environmental impacts related, for example, to pesticides, to the use of fertilizers, or to the land use are a specific theme of the agricultural part. And so if we have more a full environmental assessment of different environmental impacts, then the food or the nutrition sector becomes more important than while just looking on the global warming or the primary energy demand. A little bit of side view is, what are the possibilities for reduction of environmental impacts? Often, if I give some presentations for the consumers, they say, oh, the politics should move first, or the producers should do their part. And I think there are three major pillars in the society of drivers for these environmental impacts. There's the consumer, who finally is responsible for the final demand. The consumer has interactions with the politics by elections and or with the producers by choosing the products they are taking. Then there is a whole part of the business or the whole part of food production, for example, which influences the production patterns, which can influence also the consumers by marketing. They can influence the politics by lobbying. And last but not least, there is the politicians who determine the framework conditions on the one side, which can also educate consumers or set frameworks by laws for the business or for the consumers, but they are also depend on the other two stakeholders. And so I think there is not one to blame, but all three rules are important, and the consumer always has all of these three rules. Consumers are also citizens who can elect the politicians or make votings, and they are also working somewhere where they can influence production patterns. Now going further into more details. Food consumption can be analyzed from different points of view. And we have different types of statistics to evaluate the environmental impacts of food consumption in Switzerland. There's a market availability, which focuses on key products like wheat, beef, pork, and there's market availability statistics available for Switzerland. We have the big distributors of food, and we did studies, for example, for retailers or canteen operators, looking on their total purchases. Then we have household budget surveys, which look on the spendings of households. Well, here the food items are provided maybe also in groups, like well, people spend money in restaurants and you don't know anymore what type of food they spend their money in the restaurant, or they buy very processed food, which is made from quite a different range of ingredients. And finally, there's also studies on the food intake, so the food that really enters the mouth of the person. And at all of these stages, food wastes arise. So if you look on food intake, we have to consider the food waste in the stages before in order to derive the full picture. On the other side, if you look on the market availability, I might miss a little bit on the impacts more downstream, like processing of food, distribution of food, or taking home of the food. Here are the results of three different analyses of the food consumption. We see some differences, but well, at least the order of magnitude is correct with the different types of analyses. Market availability and household budget studies are based on life cycle assessment data, while the input-output analysis is also based on some independent data from this. And we also see in this picture, like, well, what are is the importance of different themes in the environmental assessment? Well, done with this ecological scarcity method, and we see, for example, land use or global warming, but also well, air pollutants like ammonia are relevant themes. Of course, also pesticides emissions are a relevant factor for the total environmental impacts, and yeah, some heavy metals like copper, which are used in agriculture, are also a relevant factor for the total environmental impacts. Well, then we can further split up the food consumption with the help of this LCA data. The most important part is the meat purchases and other animal products like milks and eggs. They account for about 44% of the total impacts of food consumption. A little bit surprisingly, the beverages here, wine, coffee, and beer, are important for the total environmental impacts. And oil and others is a little bit the rest category, which includes, for example, also chocolate and sweets and so on. And on the other side, we see that some products, which are often discussed, like vegetables and fruits, they are not so important from an overall view on the, of the food consumption. We also see that packages, for example, have a very small part on the total environmental impacts. Well, now we want to give guidance to consumers, and well, many consumers already heard about the environmental impacts of food consumption, but often they have difficulties to do the right thing because, well, often there are no universal statements and there's always an exception from the rule, which somehow, well, gives problems to the understanding of the consumers. Well, there is also food consumption is a very special thing because we are doing decisions on this every day quite often. So we are deciding for breakfast, for lunch, and for dinner what to eat. And it's not a one-time decision like for mobility where we decide on a car, or where we like for housing where we decide on the flat or the house where we live. And so these decisions in mobility and housing, they are much more important because they are only taken at rare occasions. But for food consumption, we have the choice every day to do a good or a bad decision. And well, of course, it's important not to do just the things which are easy to do, but to focus on these things which are really relevant from an environmental point of view. Therefore, we developed so-called reduction potentials. We looked on different themes which are well known. For example, well, we can eat vegetarian meals instead of meat-based meals, and we see, for example, here some meals are calculated for canteens. In average, there's a reduction of 66% if we eat a vegetarian meal in the canteen instead of a meat-based meal. So this will, of course, give some reduction to environmental impacts. We have compared food consumption styles, really looking on the whole basket of food consumption and compared to the average diet just shown on the left side. The vegan diet would be the one with the lowest environmental impacts. A flexitarian diet with 2 to 3 times meat a week already also reduces environmental impacts of food consumption. But on the other side, there are also diets which might increase environmental impacts, like a very meat-oriented diet or a very protein-oriented diet. And what's also interesting to see is the last column with the so-called footprints diets. That's the diet that would be necessary from an intake point of view. So the average is, again, based on the market availability of food products, but the market availability is much higher than what people actually need from a nutritional point of view. And so reducing food waste is also an important issue, which can be seen in this more theoretical exercise. If we just would produce what is necessary from a nutritional point of view, then this footprint diet could be achieved. And the footprints diet, for example, also foresees a reduction of meat consumption from now an average 7 portions per week to about 2 to 3 portions per week. Also reduction on animal products like cheese and milk and so on. And on the other side, an increase on grain products and protein products. Now, we use such single studies to evaluate the potential reduction on nutrition. And here in this case, we calculated with these nutrition scenarios, which I said, which according to this scenario, with the vegan scenario, we could reduce environmental impacts of nutrition by about 30%. So with this, these 30% multiplied with the share of nutrition in the total environmental impacts, this would give a reduction potential of about 8.6%. So if all Swiss people would follow this recommendation, the total environmental impacts of Switzerland could be reduced by 8.6%. And that's the way how we calculated for a lot of themes, these reduction potentials. And now I go to other themes, like, for example, buying organic products. Many people would have this in mind. Here we considered that the whole diet would be provided by organic products. We furthermore included that air transport and the production in heated greenhouses is not allowed for organic production in Switzerland. So this is excluded, these environmental impacts. But on the other side, we would need additional transports. It's not only for the total consumption, but also for the food consumption. Switzerland relies heavily on imported products. About 50% of the calories are imported to Switzerland. And so with the higher land use or the lower yields of organic farming, we would need more transport to still provide the same consumption basket to the Swiss consumers if you would switch to organic diet. Another difficult thing for evaluating the environmental impacts of the organic scenario is the, well, how should I say, the disagreement on the final rating on of environmental impacts. This is shown here with an example of the differences between the ecological scarcity method 2006 and 2013. In the older version of the ecological scarcity method, the organic scenario shows a reduction potential of about 8%, I have to switch here, 11%, but with the new version of this method, there's now a disadvantage or more or less equal environmental impacts of these two things. And the reason is that the weighting of important themes like the pesticides and the heavy metal emissions or the important differences between conventional and organic farming. This has changed, so pesticides get now a much lower weight in this weighting method, and they are less relevant, and so the disadvantages of organic farming get more importance in this evaluation. And well, so this we see also with the other impact assessment methods that there is no full agreement how to outweigh the advantages and disadvantages of organic farming. And this finally leads to the conclusion that it is so far not really possible to make a clear statement if organic farming is really better for the environment or not. Good. Yeah, now I come to the reduction potentials.
Niels, before you move on, there was one question, if I may ask. Did you measure the effect of food recycling, for example, table suisse, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, and was that as avoided burdens if you did indeed include it?
Well, such food recycling, finally, it should reduce the food waste and thus the market availability of food, but it's not, well, how should I say, here in the consumer's option, I have the food waste as one of the options, but I did not specifically look on this. Of course, every reduction of food waste, not only on the consumer side, but also on the production side, would be an improvement, an important one. It's an important theme in the last years, but it's not specifically measured here.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, now I come to the different options we looked at for the consumers. The first one is something like an optimized thing as a combination of different things, but we looked also on the single things like using very energy efficient appliances in the household, the A++ appliances. Resign on luxury food, alcohol, coffee, and chocolate are not necessary from a nutritional point of view, and nutritionists clearly recommend a reduction of the consumption of these items. So this would be also a possibility to reduce environmental impacts. We can look on the diet. A part of the Swiss diet has a too high body mass index or is overweighted. So what would happen if everyone would follow the recommendations for ideal weight? We can look on the less food waste, but here, well, all these options are just taken from the consumer's point of view. So just the food waste that the consumer is considered here. We looked at the no plastic bags scenario because that's a political theme. Politicians and the big retailers decided to not give away any more free plastic bags. Then this organic scenario is already mentioned. Regional food reduces mainly the air transports maybe, but as I said, Switzerland relies heavily on imports, and so supply of regional food to the Swiss society is not possible. Seasonal food would mean no fruits and vegetables from the heated greenhouse. Shopping on foot is no cars or public transport for shopping. Tap water is resigning on mineral water and drinking tap water instead. And then the vegan nutrition without animal products is one of the options. And if we compare the reduction potentials with these different options, we see that the vegan diet shows the highest reduction potentials, and there are two scales on this figure. The lower scale, the blue one, is the reduction compared to the Swiss food consumption, so about 30% again of the total impacts of food consumption could be saved by a vegan diet. On the upper scale, the total environmental impacts of Switzerland, so about 9% of the total environmental impacts could be reduced by a vegan diet. We clearly see differences between these different measures. Besides the vegan diet, the most promising options would be the refined or luxury food like coffee, alcohol, and chocolate. Then the food waste, also an important improvement option. Worse than a little bit obesity. And then we see a lot of options which do not matter much, like for example, especially the plastic bags, big discussion in public, but no visible environmental or no visible reduction of environmental impacts. Well, I said already with organic foods, it's a difficult to judge scene. Also locally and seasonally purchased vegetables and fruits, they don't show a very high reduction potential. And this is really important that consumers should focus more on the things which really matter and not so much on the things which they might see or heard about it, but which do not matter from an environmental point of view so much. Well, in a combination of these different things, I would estimate that there's a reduction potential of about 40 to 50% just for the consumers. So what they can influence by their choices and how, if they would behave in a either matter, how much they could reduce environmental impacts. Of course, there are also reduction potentials in the supply chain. For example, also avoiding food waste in the supply chain, which are not just or not yet taken into account in these reduction figures. So in principle, there would be a huge opportunity to take.
Yes, indeed, that's a huge opportunity, but we're already getting a bunch of questions about that. For example, resigning on luxury food, would you suggest 100% reduction? And is chocolate considered a luxury food, for example?
Yes, all these scenarios are calculated somehow as extreme scenarios. And so it's not possible to say how difficult it is for consumers. For some, it might be normal to take a vegan diet already. Others might never eat chocolate. So, and others might find it very hard to resign on this thing. But it's always somehow the maximum reduction potential you could achieve. Yeah. By doing this. And of course, if you just eat half of the chocolate of the Swiss average, then the reduction is also just half of it. Yeah.
And there are, of course, now questions popping up about the nutritional value of the various diets. But I think that maybe this kind of a separate discussion. But the vegan diet is indeed considered a healthy diet. So.
Yeah, that's a discussion. So in my recommendations, in this healthy and environmental friendly diet, it's important there's also meat and animal products in still. So it's more following this footprints recommendations, which are issued by nutritional scientists, and where you can say it's a healthy diet. For the vegan diet, it's of course quite some discussion about it, that while you need a lot of knowledge, I would say, to be vegan in a healthy way. And so it might, in the short term, difficult to achieve for all consumers in Switzerland. I think it's possible to have also had healthy vegan diet, but it's you might need some nutritional supplements for this, and you have to take really care to do it in a healthy way, I would say. But I'm not a nutritional scientist, so that's more what I've taken from this field of science. Well, with this approach, we can also compare the reduction potentials within nutrition to other reduction potentials. Well, nutrition, of course, nobody can resign fully on food. We all have to eat something. And so the spread is also not too large, not as large as in other consumption areas, I would say, because you cannot overconsume as much as in other consumption areas. But on the other side, you cannot eat nothing. And if you look, for example, on this mobility section there, I wrote mobile without fuel. This would be the extreme scenario that you do not enter a car, a plane, or train anymore, but just drive around by car, by bicycle and foot. And then, of course, the total environmental impacts in this area of consumption could be avoided. We see also not as extreme scenarios, just relying on public transport. I think this can be followed by a lot of people, that they do not enter private cars, for example. Well, also a lot of people might not fly with the aircraft. On the other side, you will see, of course, much higher extremes here, people flying every week somewhere for commuting, for example, which will show a very, very high environmental footprint. Then we also looked on the reduction of, for example, electric mobiles with certified electricity, of very efficient cars, of the reduction potential by electric car. And in the household, it would be, for example, economical behavior, just not heating too much. Then you can have efficient heating, efficient and insulated buildings in the this household energy sector. You can use heat pumps as the most environmentally friendly means of heating. You could use electric certified electricity and so on. And this shows a little bit also again, well, what are options which are really relevant from an environmental point of view and whatnot. Mm-hmm.
Neil, sorry, before you move on, can you just go back to the definition of what you consider the top area, the healthy and environmental friendly diet?
Yeah, it's a
What's
combination.
What's your definition here? Yeah.
It's a combination of different measures. So a reduction on the animal products, not a vegan diet, but about 2 to 3 times meat a week. Resigning on luxury food because it's not healthy. No heated greenhouses, no air transports, and less food waste. So that's, in this sense, well, it combines the different options consumers have, but without being on the absolute minimum for the diet, for the vegan diet.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, so that's repeating again what you already have heard now a few times. Well, animal products are most important for reducing environmental impacts. Resigning on luxury products is an important measure. Reduction of spoilage and overconsumption are relevant, and energy saving, household management, moving yourself instead of shopping by the car is also an option which has good health benefits in the same means. And yeah, that's a little bit of a repetition. And in Switzerland, we have such sustainably guided recommendations for nutrition. Of course, these recommendations might switch, might not be the same in different countries. Also, well, because you have cultural habits in different countries, you have different possibilities for producing food. For example, in Switzerland, it would also not make sense to fully resign on beef, meat and milk production, because we have a lot of areas where we just can produce with cows, the milk and the cheese and the meat. And so for other countries, other countries might put a higher focus on fish consumption if they have it assessed to the sea, for example, and so on. So these recommendations can also be different in different countries, depending on the natural conditions you have in the single country. Then something I just recently saw, a study from Germany, which on the right side shows also such reduction potentials. And I think they more or less meet with the things I found out. Meat consumption is very important. Reducing heating energy and improving insulation is important, or flying less is important on the one side. on the left side, the belief of consumers, and what we really see here, about 22% of consumers believe they do something good for the environment if they resign on plastic bags. So we have to forget about such things. We really have to focus on these things which matter from an environmental point of view. Also, consumers seem not to have understood enough how important this meat and meat consumption is and the consumption of animal products. And so I think there's an important discrepancy between what consumers still discuss and what LCA people find out what is important. Also for the regional and seasonal food, this really matches also with what I hear, for example, if I give presentations, that people still look a lot on these things, on the packages, on the regional and seasonal food, and on the things which are not so important. And so it's still necessary to give more facts to the society, I would say. Some myths really often stick for a long time. This might have been true maybe 20 years or 30 years ago when LCA work starts, and there was a focus on packages because people saw these packages and wanted to know more about it, but it's not true anymore today when we know everything about consumption. And so we have to put some focus on debunking such myths. We have to collaborate on this. I think that's the responsibility of scientists. Not to repeat such myths too much, and not, for example, if they are asked by journalists about their newest studies and so on, always to keep in mind the overall picture and not to focus too much on details which might not be relevant for the readers or consumers. About these facts and myths, some things, mean of transport, for example, is more relevant than the overall distance. The idea of food miles is not correct, I would say. Efficiently planned long distance transports by sea or land are often less relevant than the local production differences. I didn't discuss it here, but agricultural production can be very different in different countries. And if you, for example, from the Swiss case, move to products produced in the south of Europe, like Spain, Italy, or Morocco, often the transport from there is less relevant than buying or producing the same product in the Swiss greenhouse. But we can say avoid air transport by all means. Otherwise, forget about this idea of just looking on food miles. Then packaging, good packaging can prevent waste, and that's more important than avoiding the packaging. So if we have a good packaging, this can reduce a lot of environmental impacts compared to a bad packaging. Consumers often see this packaging and think, oh, it's bad, and but they do not value enough the importance of this packaging. And the rule for packaging is as much as necessary, as little as possible, of course. So over-packaging should be avoided, such as heavy glass bottles for olive oil or multiple packagings of where one honey is first packed in a 20 grams pack, then in a cardboard box, and then in a plastic foil. Such things that can, of course, be avoided, but most of the packagings are not a major problem. And the third move, I would say, is about this benefits of organic agriculture. So I think the ecological optimized agriculture has to combine the benefits from conventional and organic agriculture. It should be efficient, so the yield should not drop down too much on the one side. So pesticides, for example, should only be applied if necessary, but if necessary, it might be better to apply them than losing all the production on the field. Of course, it's important to close the nutrient cycles as much as possible. So there also organic agriculture runs sometimes into problems if meat is, for example, imported, and the nutrition cycle is not closed, or no, that was not correct. So if, for example, food feed for the animals is imported to a country, then the nutrition cycle cannot be closed anymore. And yeah, on the other side, if agriculture is not too extensive, there's also maybe more room for biodiversity on set aside land.
And I just want to add a little note that we are getting a lot of questions, so I'm sorry if we can't answer everything now during the session. We still have a little more than 10 minutes to go, but then we will make sure to get back to all the questions via email if we don't have time. So thank you.
No, well, I could also, here's more or less a summary of this. Yeah, I can maybe just jump through this ESO World Food Database. It's, we have about 2,500 data sets in this database related to food production and consumption, covering all areas of food products to do such studies, really investigating the whole food basket. Here are the, all the things we have in it as a, in a short view. We have a complete and consistent balancing of the food products relevant to the Swiss market here. The whole chain from field to plate is covered for many products. And we included data on food waste and water use in many data sets. And we have uncertainty information in these data sets, which allow to do Monte Carlo simulations with it. And these data are available to CIMA Pro customers as system processes. The data is available as a unit process library. And we also sell single unit or system processes or just results from this database. And then I would say we have also some time for questions.
Thanks, Nils. That was, just regarding the data, is it a complete database or can somebody also just purchase single data sets?
Yes, it's possible also to purchase single data sets. Often the problem is if you want to have unit processes, you need a range of different unit processes to have really a model of a food product, of an agricultural product like meat or greenhouse vegetables. And then sometimes it's getting very costly to buy these unit processes. It might be a better option to buy the whole database, but this I can negotiate with the customer.
Yes, and you will all, you can of course contact us at CIMA Pro Support if you want more information about the database, and or you can reach out to Nils directly. You will have his contact information at the end and in the follow-up emails. So time, looking at the time, I'll try to capture a few of the questions. So one of them was that there was a significant impact from beverages. The question is, does it come from the drinks themselves? I assume they mean the manufacturing and the inputs, or is it more attributed to the packaging and the transport of those beverages?
No, for the beverages, it's mere. Mainly these luxury beverages, as you can call it. So wine, Swiss people drink about 50 liters of wine per person and year. And in wine production, the copper applied to the vineyards is very relevant for this ecological scarcity method. Then we have beer a little bit and coffee. Also for coffee, the problem is also related to the agricultural production of the coffee and the pesticides and the copper applied in the coffee production. And these are the three relevant beverages in this section. And it's not so much about the juice and the mineral water or so, which most people would consider the main beverages they drink.
Okay, thank you. And there was another question when we were talking about the cutting down, let's say, or trying to eliminate these luxury items. What would you consider vegan chocolate? Where the results or what you're talking about is really just for dairy-based products?
I don't know if I've find it. I also have a little bit of slides there. So normally the chocolate with the highest cocoa content is the best chocolate,
okay.
I would say, which also goes more in the direction of vegan chocolate, I would say, because the milk chocolate has higher environmental impacts. So you can reduce a little bit. And normally also with a higher cocoa content, well, it's less sweet and less tasty, and I guess people eat less of such a chocolate. That's also my feeling. So that has a double effect, I would say.
Yeah, that sounds like good news. And regarding the impact of coffee, is it due to the agriculture or the heating of the water? So one question was, for example, let's say you're heating the water to make the coffee using 100% renewable energy. Well, how would that be?
Yeah, in this study for the, well, as the whole study is more based on the market availability, we have data on the kilograms of coffee beans purchased by the consumers. And the preparation of the coffee is not in very much detailed looked at this. But I would say it's so, and here it's then mainly related to the coffee production in this type of figure. Also, if you look on the coffee brewed, well, then of course the heating of the water has some importance, and there are some differences, for example, between machines which keep the coffee heated the whole day, which is a little bit of energy waste. So if you have this, beverage can there on the coffee machine, also coffee machines which are preheated the whole day might not be so efficient. So while there you can a little bit discuss on the details, but still the coffee agricultural coffee production and the processing of the coffee are relevant also for the cup drunken by the consumer. So that's a little bit different. For example, for tea, the cooking of the water is much more relevant because the tea doesn't have such a high environmental impact for its production for the leaves.
Okay. And there was a question regarding, for example, one recommendation would be to have a BMI of 25 or less, for example. But how would you measure that exactly in terms of LCA? Is that by looking at the calorific value, for example?
Well, I had a study which, or some data which said, well, the average BMI, I don't have it in mind anymore, but it's maybe 32 or so. And in order to achieve such an BMI, you need a certain overconsumption of food. So on the one side, you need to build up this BMI and you eat more. And then also in a stable case, you eat more food than you would eat if you have the lower BMI. And this additional food has been evaluated by means of LCA. So we calculated the kilograms of food which are taken in as a surplus, I would say.
And throughout your studies, the main method you've used, you have mentioned, is ecological scarcity. Have you tried using other methods like recipe? Just some users are curious about the possible changes in results if you look at other methods.
Yeah, well, most of my presentations and studies in this field have been done in Switzerland, and so most of the evaluations have been done with the ecological scarcity method. In principle, the data in CIMAPROSA can be used with all impact assessment methods. There are some, how should I say, shifts, I think, especially maybe on this question of copper, I would say. Copper is sometimes pops up as very relevant for this ecological scarcity method, like for copper and wine, for wine and cocoa and coffee. This copper application is very relevant, and there you might see some differences with other impact assessment methods. And of course, this question of organic agriculture versus conventional agriculture, there might also be the results might be different depending on the methodology you use and that's also why I said I'm careful to give recommendations on this issue.
Yeah, I can imagine. Regarding the organic versus conventional, there was a question if the difference between organic vegetables and conventional vegetables, is that similar or different to how we consider organic versus conventional meat? I don't know if you can comment on that.
I would say there is no general rule on this. So if you look on single products, you can see everything from, well, organic product is much better than conventional, but sometimes the conventional is much better than the organic one. And that's also the reason that I presented this whole basket of food consumption made as an organic basket. So it's very difficult to judge on single products. And of course, it depends a little bit how good are the products fit for the natural conditions in the country. Like, for example, carrots in Switzerland, they grow very good. And so the organic product carrots are very good also compared to the conventional ones. But potatoes, for example, there you have more difficulties because of the climate and the soil and so on in Switzerland. And then the disadvantage of organic is higher, I would say. And for example, also for the beef or cow production, the difference is not, there's not such a big difference in agricultural practice because both systems rely very much on the meadows and so on. And then the differences are smaller. So this can depend, I think, also very much on the country where you are in and the natural conditions for production in these countries. And yeah, natural conditions means the soil, the sun, the water you have on the field.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Niels. We do have a bunch of questions that I'm afraid we won't have time to answer at the moment, so we'll make sure to get back to you via email. I just want to thank you for giving us a lot of food for thought, excuse the pun, and for sharing with us the results of years of research and studies, which has been very valuable. So thanks again for your time, and thank you all for attending and for your questions. I hope you enjoyed the session, and we will be following up by email with a link to the recording. So we're getting a lot of positive reactions, so thank you so much for attending.
Thank you also from my side to all participants, and I'm looking forward to your reactions.
Okay, great. Thank you, everybody. Have a good day. Goodbye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.